We have Professor Maya Pandit. So welcome you to our webinar series. And we are very happy to have you with here. Professor Pandit, Maya Pandit is the head of the Department of English and of Shivaji University, Kolhapur. She has been the former Pro Vice Chancellor of English and Foreign Language University, Hyderabad. And she's also an activist of women's, Dalit, and teachers' movements, and having wide experience in the field of education. So we are very fortunate to have her with us to speak about her experiences with education vis-a-vis the National Education Policy 2020. So I would request Maya ji to deliver her lecture. So Maya ji, please begin.
Thank you very much, Indrani. Can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. Now I'm going to present a PowerPoint so that, you know, there are lots of points which people can look at, and then it becomes less boring also. So I think I'll share the screen now, and please let me know if you see the screen. I'll start with the slideshow straight away.
Very well.
Yeah, we can see it.
You can see it, right? Okay. I don't know why this is not started. Okay. Just give me 2 minutes.
No problem.
Yeah, it was full screen I should be making. Anyway, I'll just open it once again. Yeah. Now, you wanted me to speak on social justice and NEP 2020, new education policy proposed in 2020. And I would like to stress the fact that this is especially from a teacher's perspective, because policymakers, administrators very often forget the poor teacher and leave the teacher's perspective completely out. And it's we who are at the helm of matters in the classroom, in transactions related to the curriculum. And I think that the teacher's perspective is quite important for us to have. Now, what I'll start with the question, what is a policy? Policy is basically a word used for the rules, regulations. In fact, rules and regulations is a umbrella term, but even ideologies of on which that particular policy is based. These are what governs the operation of the educational systems. Now, what are the educational systems? Schools could be there, colleges, universities, the entire structure which governs right from salaries to educational content, curriculum development, so on and so forth, testing and evaluation procedures, etc. So it's a huge network of relations, subsystems, which creates the educational system. And the policies define what is going to be the nature of this system, what are going to be the features, and the intended outcomes, because ultimately outcomes are very important, right? The policy also defines for us the goals of education. So why are we trying to educate people? What do we intend? What is going to be the outcome of this, and how? There could be long-term goals, short-term goals. What are going to be our strategies once we arrive at the statement of goals? How do we achieve them? And what tools are we going to use in order to operationalize these strategies in the classroom and realizing the impact, measuring the impact of these strategies? It also defines for us the pedagogy. Are we going to teach? What is going to be the language of instruction? How are we going to teach? what resources have we got at our disposal, how we are going to do resource mobilization, what kind of curriculum we are going to have at different levels of the educational process, so on and so forth. And then, of course, the impact on possible groups. Now, there are three major aspects of any educational, any policy, in fact, whether it is economic policy or political policy or social policy, gender policy, educational policy. And these are the context. First, it is the context, that is the antecedents, what has happened earlier, and the pressures leading from what has happened earlier, the developments that have been taking place, and their a desire to solve the problems arising out of the pressure. So this is known as the context of the development of the policy. Then text will be the content of the policy, right? How actually it is written down, what are the elements in it, what are the ideas in it, strategies specified, and then of course the consequences. So what are the now remember, there will be interpretations of the policy. You are listening today to my interpretation. Tomorrow somebody will come and give another interpretation. But of course, for any interpretation to be there, you must have a hypothesis which is very clearly marked. Okay, my hypothesis is education has to be for development of the oppressed. That is going to be the perspective from which I'm going to look at the policy. So, however, there will be different kinds of interpretations of the policy, and they may result in diverse policies and programs for the interpretation, which the administrators, the implementers will do. In the context, we need to look at the historical, old historical context, because some of these problems continue even today, and I'll talk about them in a minute. I won't take too much time. But you must have heard this word, and even the educational policy reiterates this, 2020, the Vedic system from ancient times. And I'll speak a little more about the Vedic system. So in Rigveda, for instance, you find that you don't get a detailed description, but obviously learning of the rituals and learning recitation of these. And of course, this was highly connected to the religious and other aspects of learning. We don't know much about this system, of course. But whatever evidence we get from historical texts, that we can use, historical accounts. Then comes the Buddhist system, which is a non-Vedic system. And I'm going to take half a minute more for this, because it was the context between Buddhism and conflict between the Buddhists and the Vedicas. Now, the Vedicas and the Avedicas also, you could say. But the Buddhists basically defined policies which were more people-centric. For instance, you know, Takshashila, Nalanda, these are the universities. The 2020 NEP also does refer to them. But basically, the education used to take place in the Viharas. And it was very democratic. Why was it democratic? Because you must know that India is, and we all know this, right, that India is a stratified society. It's made up of different castes, and there is a hierarchical relationship between these castes. So obviously people who are at the top will always get advantages, including education. But the Buddhists, whoever went to the Buddhists for education in the Viharas, they got education. And you have even Chinese philosophers, Chinese travelers from many different places actually coming and visiting these universities and receiving education. But after the 7th, 8th century with the Vedicism, again, the Brahminical systems dominated the Buddhist system, the Jain system, etc., the non-Vedic systems, etc. And then the Brahminical systems tried to reinforce the hierarchies of the Chaturvarna system. Now, you know that, Chaturvarna is, it's a ladder, and it's a ladder of hierarchical relationships. And where the Brahmin dominates, the four Varnas. I won't go into the Chaturvarna system. Everybody knows about it, so I won't spend too much time on it. But you can rest assured that people who were on the lowest, and, you know, you have the Brahmins and the the other varnas arranged below that, but the today what we call the Dalits, for instance, they were the Pancham Varnas. They are not even included in this system. So Brahmin and Kshatriyas, Vaishyas and Shudras, and nobody talks about the Atishudras. Atishudra is not included even in the Purusha Sukta. These people were permanently kept out of the educational system, and therefore education was limited only to the upper crust of the society, that is the Brahmins in the society, Brahmin class in the society, caste. After 11th, 12th centuries, once the Muslims dominated India, then the Muslim educational system came into existence, and it was a predominantly religious education system based on two different kinds of education. One was Maktaba, which was related to the primary education of literacy development, Urdu, of course, Persian Urdu, and then madrasas. Madrasas were basically for religious education, and these were used to be attached to the mosques. In the Brahmin, in the Muslim rule, even some of the non-Muslims would go to the maktaba or madrasa and receive, not madrasa, but at least maktaba, to receive literacy skills. That evidence is available. Now, all of this system ended with British India. Now, when religion was so closely intertwined with education, that system, there was an epistemic break, as we call it, once the British came to India. And they did lots of things. I mean, before the British actually established their domination on India, the missionaries had already started work, started translating the Bible, opening schools of various kinds. And then, for the first time in 1813, because initially there was a conflict of interest between the missionaries and the British government, the company Sarkar. But then in 1813, which is known as the Charter Act of Education, the British government decided to set aside a total amount of 1 lakh for the education of Indians. Now, 1 lakh is hardly a pittance, you know that. But I'm talking about very ancient history, not very ancient, but even then 1 lakh rupees were quite something. And a new direction was opened for the education of all the missionaries, had already started taking education to the non-Brahmin oppressed classes of society, including the Brahmins. Okay, it's not just for non-Brahmins, but the Brahmins were very cunning people. They found advantage in everything. So they were the first to receive education, even with these schools and the pundits and the gurus, helped the government to translate some of these documents, rules and regulations and dharmic texts and stuff into English after learning English. But the real break with this came with T.B. Macaulay, and his minutes are very famous in 1835, where he talked about a committee of public instruction and decided to use English as the medium of instruction. Till then, we were using mother tongues as the medium of instruction, and there was this, liberals and analysts fighting with each other what should be the language of as medium of instruction. And Elphinstone, for instance, the governor of Mumbai, for instance, was in favor of the native languages, because he thought they would be the best medium through which English education can be grafted, English knowledge can be, European knowledge can be grafted on this fertile soil of Indian mind. Anyway, so Macaulay's Anglicist policy preserved, and English began to be used as a medium of instruction. The Woods Dispatch of 1853-54, it's called the Magna Carta of Indian Education, where a uniformity was brought into the educational system all over India. Many more schools were opened. And another thing that it did was the beginning of Indian universities. You know that the first three universities were found in Mumbai, Kolkata, and Chennai. And that was how today's modern education began. Now, I won't spend, as I said, let us come to independent India, because the legacy of some of these problems we carry forward even in NEP 2020. So we need to look at this. Education has always been, even during British time, has always been the monopoly of the upper castes. Gradually, you see democracy seeping in. And till we come to independent India, the University Education Commission of 1958 declared that education was meant as a commodity for all. The Mudaliar Commission, which came after that, 52, it highlighted the diversification of high school courses, establishment of multi-purpose high schools. In fact, each of these committees, we could go into details and talk more about it, but we don't have time. And then the most important policy, Kothari Commission, which came into over 3 years, 66 to 68. And Kothari had a huge team of workers, scholars all over the country working for him. They took huge surveys. They studied even tiny, tiny new universities, how, what kind of curriculum they were using, what were the demands of those people. Huge amount of work. If you really look at the Kothari Commission, it's immense, the amount of work that they did to arrive at the policy. And they defined education for prosperity, welfare, and security of the people, which is extremely important. These goals were very important because India was now a newly independent country, and it was a free country, and everybody had wanted to assert their right, their freedom, equality, fraternity. These were the values of the basic values of the constitution, and education also was charged with these. Education for social, economic, and political change. An important break from the earlier policies that the Kothari Commission sought to bring in was the regional languages. Role of the regional languages was increased, and the three language formula came into being. So you had to learn the mother tongue, you had to learn the state language, the national language. All languages are national languages, whatever is included in the schedule of Indian languages. But then English and Hindi became two languages for government correspondence, government work, etc. And regional languages were supposed to be used by the state. The national policy of education of 1986, which the Rajiv Gandhi government ushered in, this was accompanied by a national program of action as well in 1992. This is very important because whatever goals have been stated there have been operationalized. Strategies have been specified in action program. And then you have the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, especially 2000 onwards of DPEP, which went for universalization of primary education, because still there were huge number of people who were illiterate. Education hadn't been able to reach. So, Right to Education Act in 2009, from elitism to egalitarianism spread of university education, these were the two things that we find after 2009 Right to Education Act. But we need to look at some major points of NEP 1986, because just as it spelled out certain new tendencies, strategies, it also resulted into lots of problems too. And the NEP 2020 says that we are trying to build up on the problems of the previous generation, previous educational policies. We need to understand this too. Now, in 1986, the NEP had specifically stated that the emphasis of education would be on the education of the scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, OBCs, and women, the most oppressed sections in the society. It also said that they would give fellowships for poor students. And you know that there are lots of fellowships up to research level, Rajiv Gandhi fellowships, etc. They were started. They also started in a very big way adult education programs, and universities were given huge grants for undertaking adult education programs. Focus was added to technical education as well, okay, which wasn't there earlier, but now with the new government, the new economic structures coming in, World Bank, World Trade Organization, so on and so forth, and I'll talk about this in a minute, but technical education became a requirement, professional and technical education. Then there was another policy matter which was very important. Teachers began to be recruited from oppressed groups. So you have the reservation policies being made stringent. People couldn't get away with, appointing. That happens everywhere. We know that there are rule breakers. But at least on paper, there was a lot of opportunity provided, percentage of reserve posts in teachers from oppressed groups. There was emphasis on opening more primary schools, naturally. Then importance was given also to open universities, and in India, open universities began to function in a big way. Emphasis on educational technology also was a new field of concentration for NEP 1986. Now, before I go on to these, I would like to talk about a few problems, which I'll talk later, because that is a link. The problems is a link between 1986 and 2020. But what happened, apart from the policy in 1986, the NEP 2020 also is based upon Sustainable Development Summit held by UNO countries, United Nations, member states. They adopted a 2030 agenda. What is this? This means that these nations came together all over the world. They had a meeting and they decided that till 2030, certain things will definitely be done in the field of education. In the field, I'll specify what those fields are. But if we want to have a sustainable development, then we cannot address only one or two issues. It's all an integrated strategy. And they came up with a program of different goals. Education is the fourth goal. So it contains a set of 17 different goals for sustainable development. And India adopted this agenda for its implementation in all its states in 2015, the same year, because we were also party to it. And the goal of the agenda, the main goal was change the world for the better. Now look at the 17 goals for sustainable development. They're all interlinked. I won't go into all of these. You can see that quality education forms a fourth goal, but it's also connected to climate action, poverty alleviation, zero hunger, health, work and economic growth, reducing inequality. That is one of the major goals. So on and so, peace, justice, and strong institutions and partnerships. Okay. Now we'll see how partnerships are interpreted in the NEP 2020 in a short while. But these are the 17 goals for all of the countries all over the world for a sustainable development for everybody. Now, goal 4 is education. What does it say? What does it want to have? It says ensure inclusive, equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all, not for a few. Free primary and secondary education, equal access to quality pre-primary education too. Equal access for all affordable and quality technical, vocational and tertiary education, including the universities. Increase the number of youth and adults who have relevant skills, including technical and vocational skills for employment. We'll see how this is also interpreted in a very different way. Decent jobs and entrepreneurship. These are the goals of education. It also says we want to eliminate all discrimination in education. Ensure that all learners acquire the knowledge and skills. Build and upgrade education facilities that are child, disability and gender sensitive. This is again another point I'm going to take it up. Provide safe, non-violent and inclusive and effective learning environment for all. And the most important, one of the most important things, increase supply of qualified teachers, right? Now, if you look at all these goals, it's like, you feel like you are in a wonderland. It's such a beautiful language. And we'll see that this is all. It's a dreamer's paradise, all these goals. And you immediately feel so, wonderful about it, that this is so good. And we are going to have this. That is what Zavadekar ji claimed when he was releasing this. We'll see actually what happens here. Now, what were the, now you see, 86, we have something. Then comes a program of action. Then till today, what were the major problems with that? Because we understand those need to understand those problems and also understand these new goals on the world level. And we have adopted that. So we are a party to it. We are committed to putting that agenda through our educational policies. Now, the problem was the previous education policy, the NEP 1986, there were wonderful recommendations, but as usual, huge gaps between what is in the cup and what comes to the lip. They were going to take education to the people. Actually, what happened was lots of people were denied educational opportunities. And I'll tell you why in a minute. Policies are also influenced by contemporary political agendas. That created a problem. For instance, in Maharashtra and many other states, they started in the 90s with a policy of English from the first standard. Now, I've been a teacher developer all my life. And in one of the training we used to hold, training sessions for primary teachers. And one teacher said, she literally broke down in the class. And she said, "Madam, I can't even say properly two sentences in English. And you want me to tell stories, play games, give instructions, do the entire classroom management transactions in English? I'm going to resign from my job." It was without any head or tail. There were teachers that just pushed into the classroom and say, told to teach all this in English at the primary level. And there was mushrooming of bad English medium schools. One of my students has done a PhD on this. What kind of English is taught? And he discovered that it was beyond description. It beggared description for so bad. Growth in the number of educational institutions in the private sector, which were encouraged because of the new privatization policy of the government, huge fee rise in professional courses. So you go, you want to be a dentist, you want to go to, you want to be a BA teacher, DA teacher, you want to be a doctor, you have to pay hefty donations. And you know that once upon a time in Maharashtra, in my own university where I was working, people had sold off even their land to pay donations to private colleges to be admitted into the BA course. Many people were pauperized because of this. But 1980s, the later part, was the decade when privatization of education entered and dominated. Education became a field for earning profits. It posed a serious challenge to both educational planners and policymakers. Obviously, the private education, the private people who were coming into education, they were not coming in for, you know, charged with some, there were people who were charged with the spirit of social revolution, etc. But these people, the sugar factories, the huge corporates came slightly later, but they were unable to, they were not coming there to restore balance between, you know, give power to the oppressed. They were there to earn profits. And profit making does not have any idea about social service. You want to read all of this in a detailed way, you can read the history of education policy in India. And I've given the content here, the address here. So creation of a layered system was seen. There was a public system, there was a private system, and they called it public-private partnership. Unfortunately, this was supposed to work in sync with stratified fabric of the system. What is stratified? Graded. Where people are not at all living a life of equality at all. 60-70% of people were below any educational, and they couldn't afford to pay those hefty fees and go to the private schools. Naturally, money on public system of education, I'll show you some figures, you know, later on. But This completely denied any access to the poor to quality education in the first place and to educational opportunities in the second place for many professional courses. Okay, so you just be a B.Ed, B.Sc, whatever, you don't get any job. And number of unemployed people increased phenomenally. Then at the school level, they also, Kendriya and Navodaya Vidyalayas, which widened this gap. And then persistent testing became a norm. So at every drop of a hat, every 3 days, every 5 days, every week, there is a test. Teachers have to maintain records of all these. Teachers' workload, and not academic workload, these keeping records increased phenomenally during these 20 years, which affected these teachers very badly. I worked with a British Council project in understanding what could be the continuous professional development strategies used at these people. And most of the teachers said that in schools, ma'am, we can't do any other work except cater to whatever, record filling. And naturally, a record filling is taking so much of your time, you fill up records 2-3 months ahead. Managerial discourse came to dominate educational scenario. Now, we come now to NEP 2020. We have understood the problems of the previous system policies. We have understood the new goals set by, and now we come, because the NEP right at the beginning states it very emphatically that they have derived this policy document based in the framework of goals stated by policy for sustainable development. Now, let me make one thing very clear. NEP 2020 is only a policy document. There is no plan of action. Maybe it will come later and we'll know more about it. But right now, it's only the policy document. There is no plan of action. It's a very tiny document, 65 pages. It specifies strategy, a broad direction. It claims to provide a complete overhaul of existing educational system with reforms and changes at all levels, it claims. Very ambitious claim. It's not based, unfortunately, on any study of educational scenario in the country as the Kothari Commission had done. Kothari Commission had done a very, very thorough study. NEP 2020 seemed to have some 25-30 people sitting together, and people from various European countries, American countries. I have nothing against Europeans or Americans. So far as the policies that they give us are useful to us. Now, we'll come to the policies in a minute. But the underlying philosophy can be summarized in the three C's. What are the three C's? Centralization, commercialization, and communalization. Centralization means keeping all power concentrated at some particular organization point. Commercialization is what the NEP 86 tried to do. Use education as a commodity to earn profits. Sell it. It's not your social commitment. It's not your goal of bringing changes, transforming your society, but crass commercialization. And the third is communalization. Build up the religious divides still stronger. The three C's. Now let us take we'll look at the policy statement in more details, but before that, we need to understand the existing scenario by way of number of schools, number of higher institutions, colleges, universities, etc. This will take a little time, but I'll just read out the final tally. Okay, number of schools, primary, upper primary, secondary, etc. You have 15,22,346 schools. 15-16. This data is from 15-16, but give or take a few here and there, the number will not change substantially. Then the management wise, that is government, government aided and private unaided, you can see 15 lakh thereabouts. Okay. Look at the number of private unaided schools. Okay. That will make a point very clear. Look at the universities, 799 universities at present of different kinds. There are central universities, 43 only, maybe add a couple of universities here and there. A deemed state, state private, central open, state open, institution of national importance, etc. This comes to 39,071. Okay. Compared to the schools, the universities are rather small in number for a huge country like India. And then the colleges. Okay. So if you look at this, 39,071 colleges. And standalone institutions. So, you know, diploma level, technical, nursing, teachers training, institute under institutes under ministries, etc. This comes to 12,000. Same. Now look at, this is the existing scenario. And this is important. Remember some of these figures. Now they are saying that we want to revamp and restructure the entire system. This system that I just now showed you. And they say, and this sounds so beautiful, you've taken in immediately, universal access to quality. These are statements and phrases which are taken from set of goals. So ensure inclusive, equitable quality education for all, prepare and provide new skilled labor, gainful employment, multidisciplinary. You think of it, this is the same thing that I read earlier. And then there is one addition here, which you must learn. Pedagogy to be more experiential, holistic, integrated, inquiry-driven, discovery-oriented, learner-centered, all words from there. And then ancient and eternal Indian thought, a guiding light to develop moral and ethical values and to become Vishwaguru. Now, these are two added things. I don't know how you... talk about ancient and eternal. If something is eternal, then change is not possible, no? Because eternal means it's alive, it's there, it's unchanging. Can we really think of this as an eternal thought that gives us a frame of reference? And what do you mean by Indian thought? Because India is a very multilingual, multi-religious, multi-social communities, etc., etc. It's a multilingual country. It's a multicultural country. So what do you mean by Indian thought? They mean the Hindu thought. And why I'm saying this, I'll explain in a minute. And then to, of course, become the Vishwaguru, I think this is a very arrogant kind of a statement. Who are you to teach the whole world? In spite of you, the tremendous Indian system, Indian culture you talk about, how many scientists have you produced? How many Nobel laureates have you produced? How many wonderful institutions of learning have you produced? Research institutions have you produced? How many patents are on your name to use your own language? How many new inventions and discoveries have you allowed your students and teachers to come up with, researchers to come up with? How much research grant do you give to your institutions? You know, and you want to become the Vishwa Guru? You want to teach the whole world how great you are? Rubbish. I'm sorry, but you know, sometimes you really feel that this is not fair. It's not fair to the world. It's not fair to ourselves also, because then we are enveloped in a fog, in a myth of our own greatness. And we feel that we don't need anything from outside. It's all foreign. In the field of knowledge, you can't really make those kinds of comparisons anyway. Now, what are the actual changes? The old system was 2 years, 10 years from 6 to 16, the primary system. Then 2 years of 16 to 18, you know, the junior college, as we call it, 11th, 12th. Within which you had the primary and secondary. From up to 8th, you have primary, then 9th, 10th, you have secondary, then you have. Now the new system says you start with Balavatika, age 3 to 6. Then you have, this is the foundational course, class 1 to 2. Then you have preparatory, class, class 3 to 5. Middle school from 6 to 8. And secondary school from 9 to 12. Why actually has this been made? There is no justification for this. Anyway, I would say, okay, fine, wonderful. You want to have Balavatika? It will reduce the, you know, load on new mothers, new fathers, especially working mothers, etc., where their children are taken care of by way of Anganwadis or whatever it is. So, okay, fine. Now, they are saying, and this comes in features of this streaming, early streaming of vocationalization. There is only one good point here. They are saying that we will use mother tongues for teaching at the primary level, which is wonderful. Again, there is a problem. I'll come to that in a minute. So, is your policy an attempt to create workers for the industry? You know, the Indian caste system is based on stratification of work. Every caste is supposed to do certain work, except the Brahmins, they don't do any work. But all the other castes are given some particular kind of work. Now, you are saying early streaming of vocationalization. Given the kind of social situation that you have, are you trying to build up, strengthen the existing caste structure? So, lohar ka ladka lohari banega, sutar ka sutari banega. What are you, why early streaming? I mean, suppose somebody wants to go ahead with, you know, advanced learning. Wo usko chhod hi dena chahiye fir 12th ke baad. Now, they are talking about, we all talk about constitutional values like liberty, equality, fraternity, right? These are our constitutional values, we swear by them. Instead of reiterating these values, they are only once mentioned. But you have seva, swachhata, sacrifice, courtesy, dharmic duty. Now, if you see this in conjunction with the existing caste inequalities, religious inequalities, how do you make sense of this? What is dharmic duty? Is my dharmic duty to commit sati? Is my dharmic duty to shave off my head? Is my dharmic duty to come to, you know, not go to schools at all? Work, sit at home and work in the house? What is my dharmic duty as a woman? What is my dharmic duty as a Dalit? As a Muslim? And what is seva, swach seva? I am supposed to spend all my life in doing seva to the others. Like all the three varnas, four varnas, including the Atishudras, will have to do seva to the Brahmins, to the upper castes. How do you actually define dharmic duty? What is that word doing here? And why not liberty, equality, fraternity? Which are constitutional values? Why sacrifice? We've been doing sacrifices for the country all the time. Why are you making us do sacrifices even in the constitutional framework, education policy? Okay. Then comes the three language formula plus Sanskrit. This is a continuation from the earlier three language formula plus Sanskrit. Now, why Sanskrit? I have nothing against that language. It's a beautiful language. There is a wonderful literature available in that language. I love that language. I can read a little bit, understand. But why? Why Sanskrit? If somebody doesn't want to learn Sanskrit, why do you impose it? It can be learned at, you know, as an option. You are doing a menu of many subjects. Why Sanskrit? Obviously, you are trying to bring a backdoor entry to the domination of the Brahmins once again. And apart from that, also moral ethical education, which is very funny. Emphasis on Sanskrit and Indian Brahminical texts. Panchatantra, for instance. I could go into, you know, analyzing stories from the Panchatantra, Hitopadesh, so on and so forth. What is wrong with, I have nothing against these storybooks. But you can't say that they are the texts to be taught in schools or read in schools only. These are only the texts. The whole world, in fact, why go to the whole world? Even India, if you look at the Santal Katha, for instance, the Santali people have lots of wonderful tales. Adivasis have of different kinds. Each country, for instance, if you go to the Eastern Indian country, Nagaland, Manipur, Mizoram, wonderful tales. I've heard these tales. My teachers have told me these tales and they are amazing. Why not use those tales? They may not be Hindu tales. Why do you want Hindu tales? Why Hitopadesh? Why Panchatantra? Which are trying to bring in strengthen the caste structure in some way or the other. Existing inequalities justify them. Okay. Lip service to multilingual education. This is what they have said, that multiple languages will be used for education. But if you look at the early, later references, teaching only in 22 languages. India has more than 3,000 languages. Do you know that Maharashtra alone has more than 60 major dialects? 60. Have you ever tried to bring them into education? Have you ever tried to employ teachers who will teach through these languages, at least the primary years? Have you got textbooks? Have you got materials, resources? Have you appointed committees? I'm not saying that they should be used as mediums of instruction till the 12th. I'm saying initial foundation of education should be only in the mother tongue, because a mother tongue is the language through which you understand your basic foundations of concepts. Okay. Now, what happens to rights of minority language users? I speak some kind of a Varadi language. I speak Airani. That is a major dominant language of Marathi, dialect of Marathi. But I have to learn standard Marathi. Now, look at the tribal children. Look at these minority language using children. They have to learn their own language, but they can't learn because there is no way they can learn it. Then they have to learn the state language, all education. State language for any Santhali child through Oriya is also a foreign language. Pune Marathi for an Airani student will be a foreign language. The child is using then state language, Hindi and English and plus Sanskrit. What happens to his own language, her own language? These languages will die. And besides, these students, because they can't learn in their mother tongue, they leave school. Dropouts, huge number of dropouts in schools where their own language is not used. So there is only a vague mention of induction of local languages in their literature. There is nothing beyond that. Because NCERT or SCERT are going to prepare the content. Now see, you go to the market and if you're told you have to buy only this shirt, whether you're fat, you're slim, you're tall, you're short, one shirt. Will we ever do things like that? Every person has to use a shirt which fits him. How can one shirt fit all? How can one structure fit everybody's needs? And then excessive emphasis in formative assessment, which increases teachers' workload in multiple ways. Look at college education. This was about school education. Look at college. Now they have suddenly decided that the undergraduate course will be 4-year degree course. No justification. Why? Some American universities do it. 3-year degree course is used all over the world. See, in India, providing for a children's education for 3 years in college itself is a burden. Especially it's a burden for girl students because parents say, tu ghar ka kaam seekh le beta, tu kya karegi? Ab with a little bit of scholarship, little bit of this, that and the other, saheli ja rahi hai, ye wo, they go to the college. Now you are making it 4 years. Obviously, this is going to have an adverse impact. I mean, there is no real justification. What I'm saying is, if there is a justification, give it to us and we'll see. No justification, because American universities use it. America does a lot of things. Do you do that? Then, if you have only 1 year of college, you are given a certificate. 2 years, diploma. 3 years, degree. And 4 years, research. Then they have said interdisciplinary education where there are more courses on the menu. If there are more courses, you need to appoint more teachers. And we'll come to how much money is spent on education and we'll see. Then all colleges to be autonomous in 15 years. Suddenly all colleges in 15 years become autonomous. They have excellent teachers, excellent facilities, excellent libraries, excellent research facilities. Everything in 15 years is going to be autonomous. ये समझ रहा है. ऑब्वियसली दिस इज अ स्टेप फॉर प्राइवेटाइजिंग एजुकेशन. देन नाउ यूनिवर्सिटीज विल बी एट डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल्स. देर आर 718 डिस्ट्रिक्ट इन इंडिया. So now you are opening up more and more, open up universities. I have no problem with that. My problem is all the colleges at the nooks and corners of a district. There are villages. There are small places where there are colleges. They are very useful for the girls, for the poor children who can travel to those colleges without spending too much money. Sometimes in the district place is far away from the outskirts. How are students going to reach there? Again, this is going to adversely impact education of girls, education of poor students. Why this distinction between teaching universities and research universities? I have spent all my life in university education. Why do you want to make this distinction? Make all universities research friendly, give them grants, they will do a good job. But you want to keep the prerogatives of resources to only research universities. And you want to scrap teaching universities. I mean, scrap in the sense, wo scrap ke bhav mein hi jayenge, raddi ho jayenge. Then they have also decided to scrap MPhil degree. Now I'll tell you, many of my students found the MPhil degree very useful because it was a kind of training for them to do research. It's not a big degree, I know. It's better than ME. But it enabled the students to read on its own, form hypotheses, try it out, write a research, a dissertation of 120 pages. It's a way of training a researcher. You've scrapped it completely. So after MA, the student will directly go into the PhD now. And then creation of model universities. Why? Why make this distinction between model universities and other universities? So the NEP 86 had only schools for the rich, the bright, and schools for the poor, the Kendriya Vidyalayas and the other. The same logic operates here also. So affiliating universities stop. Poor students, girls, etc. Whatever I was saying, so I won't spend too much time on this. And then the privatization drive that was taking by 1986 policy is increased to a fullest extent here. Only they call it public, not public private, but public philanthropic partnership. Wonderful word, philanthropy. Which businessman, except for a very, very few chosen people, who have not used education for minting money? Tell me. All these private universities that are coming up, mushrooming all over the country, you call them public philanthropic partnership. They are going to be allowed to apply more fees. They will take more fees. And then they were expected to invest a little bit of that into education. So basically you are saying that dukaan kholo, jitna chahe utna profit kamao. Bas thoda 4-5 paise, 10 rupiya idhar udhar de dena, bas ho gaya. Private institutions are allowed to have their own free structure, profit expected to be back in education, but the government is not going to have any control over these. How do you check whether they have put in what percentage of their, ab jahan PM CARES fund ke bare mein koi baat nahi kar sakta, ye private universities ke fund ke bare mein kaun baat karega ji? Who will talk about, who will dare to ask questions about this? Teachers' jobs, which is an area of worry for me, will be more micromanagerial and also transferable. This is going to compound the problems for teachers. And one huge overarching, UGC se apne colleges dekhna nahi hota universities. Aap UGC, MCI, everything is going to be brought under one heading, centralization. So why are you doing this centralization? Is it going to make things easier for you to operate? Or is it going to make things more difficult to operate? look at financial provisions, and I want you to listen to this very carefully. Aspects of social justice, you see, they say 6% of GDP is spent on education. We plan to, huh? And then this will be increased to 10% of GDP on education, because we want to have different aspects of social justice like affirmative action, flexibility, vocational education to be brought in. And we want financial autonomy and private philanthropy. Now, let us just look at, I'm not talking about private philanthropy because I don't have the figures. Why would they give me figures about how much money they have earned and how much money they spent actually on education? But I'll drop this slide. We don't have time. I want you to have a look at this. This is Union Government's budget. Okay. Out of Union budget and out of GDP. Okay. There are two sections here. Each column has a very tiny, faint column at the bottom. So the figure that you see as a dark yellow, that is percentage spent on education of Union budget. And the small, faint, can you see this here? Big pillar is accompanied by a small, tiny box. That is expenditure on education as percentage of GDP. Do you want to know this? 4.1% of Union budget in 14-15 of GDP, 0.55. And you can look at these figures, except at one place. It rises only up to 50.55 in 14-15. It's downhill. 44.44, 0.46 GDP. These are people who are saying will 10% of GDP. This is the history of spending on expenditure on education. Look at the next one. There is a group of BRICSAM countries. Okay, I have got here 5 countries. There are 2 more. Malaysia I haven't got, and Russia I haven't got. A couple of others maybe. But these are the, out of 7, I have got figures for 5. Look at this expenditure. Public expenditure on secondary education in BRICSAM countries as percentage of GDP. You remember the earlier slide? Less than 0.5% of GDP. 0.44, 0.45, 0.46. Look at these countries. Brazil. 2.5, 2.6, 2. This is 10, 11, 12. You can see the graph. And look at in India. 0.9, 1 and 1. Indonesia is almost as much as us. South Africa, double. South Africa, we say, we are so advanced. We are going to be Vishwagurus. Haan, aapka jiye GDP ka percentage isme nahi spend kar rahe ho. Vishwaguru banne ki aadat chahat hai aapko. I mean, this is rubbish. They haven't even looked at their own figures. Now, apart from these, my point is, you open universities, you open this university, that university, research university, ordinary universities, blah, 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 blah. I have showed you all. And then you say, 1% bhi GDP ka kharcha nahi hota is pe. Has not increased in the last, ab to baat hi karne ka mauka nahi hai, chodo, corona ke period mein. Where is that money going to come from? Again, education will be the prerogative of the rich. Of the upper castes. Women will suffer, Muslims will suffer, downtrodden people will suffer, workers will suffer, Adivasis will suffer, Dalits will suffer. Paisa aayega kahan se? Aap to entry ki darwaze hi band kar rahe. Alright. Now look at what the policy does or does not do. Ignore. The policy is blind in some senses. There are other ignored, and I'm coming to the end of my presentation. I'm sorry, I have taken a little more time. But students with special needs and students with diverse disabilities, they are mentioned all right. Nothing more than that. Blind students, physically challenged students, acoustically challenged students. Kisi ka limb nahi hai, kisi ko kuch hai, kuch hai. Won't privatization affect them? Which private school, I mean, there are NGOs and I have respect for their work. the NGOs are so expensive. Their schools are expensive. They won't spend for a poor man's blind child. Why would they? They are not earning any profits. Why would private institutions open schools for them? So blind, physically challenged, autistic students, nobody's baby. No policies for accommodation and facilities for these kids. No directive for policy statement doesn't even talk about special schools for these. Unke physical, they have to have different sets of physical. Bathroom jana hai, problem hai. You have to have a different kind of bathroom for them. Drinking facility different hona chahiye. Blind students ke liye libraries hone chahiye with that, you know, mechanism for reading. Kahan se laoge aap? आप पैसा ही खर्च करने को तैयार नहीं है एंड यू आर सेइंग दैट प्राइवेट इंस्टीट्यूशंस विल टेक केयर ऑफ दिस. आर वी स्टूपिड पीपल? उल्लू बनाया जा रहा है क्या हमको? अब इनके पास, इन बच्चों को अगर पढ़ाने के लिए स्कूल्स नहीं है तो नेचुरली पेरेंट्स को काम करना है. ये लॉट्स ऑफ पेरेंट्स डू दिस, बट एज इट इज पुअर पेरेंट्स आर क्रश्ड अंडर द लोड ऑफ बर्डन ऑफ एवरीडे वर्क in order to make ends meet. These children have special needs. They have to be fulfilled. They have to be taught to be self-reliant. How are you planning to do this? By putting the whole load on parents' heads? Nothing for education of the LGBT communities. They have not said anywhere that the biases will be removed. Caste biases will be removed. Gender biases will be removed. They use all the language of the, you know, but without matching it with equal kind of commitment to those goals. What you see is nothing but the naked face of a very communalized agenda, upper caste agenda, upper caste agenda, Hindu agenda. There is no policy for mental health issues. People may be all right superficially, physically, but they may be mentally challenged, disturbed. There are different kinds of, you know, diseases, disorders that young children suffer from. Where are going to be the teachers who are, where are they coming from? How are you going to produce teachers for this? How are you going to produce different kinds of textbooks for them? All of these questions are completely unanswered, unnoted, dropped. Is this an educational policy or are you making a joke of education? That's my question. I'm sorry, sometimes I really feel so angry about this because, you know, on the one hand, you are saying that, you know, I mean, you are not even taking, talking about equality, fraternity, the goals of our, the foundational virtues of our constitution, you're talking about dharmic values. Is this the dharma? What dharma are you talking about? For me, this educational policy 2020 is a plot. It's a plot against the poor. It's a plot which has a communal agenda, a privatization agenda. And this is in turn going to be extremely adverse effects on all of those people in the society who are poor, who are oppressed, who are challenged in different ways, who are weak, and who are, of course, downtrodden workers, Muslims, lower castes, Adivasis, you name it. What do you see in the policy of these, for these people? Again, I'm keeping my comments a little reserved because the plan of action has not come yet. Let me see what the plan of action is. But I don't think that plan of action will have something gloriously different. It will be reiteration of the same things. I'm very thankful to you. I'm very sorry in the first place because I took a little more than what time you had given me, 10 more minutes. I thank Idrani ji, Jagmohan ji, and all the people from your committee for inviting me here. listening so patiently to what I had to say, and I'm very thankful to all of you for giving a patient ear. If there are any questions, of course, yes. Shall I switch this off?
Now we will have a Hindi translation of it, and then after that we will have questions. I will request Ramamurthy ji to, he is a very good helper to us in translating. So Ramamurthy ji, please give a gist of the ideas, wonderful ideas given by Professor Mayal.
गुड इवनिंग और सभी को वृंदाबाद. मैं कोशिश करूंगा कि माया जी ने अपनी हिंदी में भी रखकर उसका अनुवाद कर सके. मुख्य रूप से सबसे पहले आपने ये बताने की कोशिश की कि नीति का मतलब क्या होता है. तो आपने ये बताने की कोशिश की जो नीति होती है उसमें मुख्य रूप से कुछ नियम, उपनियम, व्यवस्थाएं, उपव्यवस्थाएं होती है जिन्हें लागू करने के लिए किसी ढांचे का एक संकल्पना होती है और उस ढांचे के फिर विस्तार में किस तरह से कार्यान्वित किया जाएगा उसका एक खाका भी होता है जो हर एक नीति का अपने तरीके का हो सकता है. उदाहरण आपने दी कि जेंडर संबंध में नीति हो सकती है, लैंगिक नीति, किसी राजनीतिक विषय पर नीति हो सकती है, आर्थिक नीति हो सकती है,
sound is coming, Ramamurthy ji.
Just a second, ma'am. Okay now, ma'am.
Hello.
No, it may be. But you have some loose this connection or something like that.
From my side at all now. Everything is closed down. मतलब कोई अभी भी यार वो connected.
Sound is still there, Ramamurthy ji. I don't know whether Jagmohanji, are you finding this sound? Maybe
yeah, there is a noise. There is a noise. Some loose connection.
Can I do that?
Okay, you can reconnect.
Is there any fan on in his room? He can switch off the fan. It might be disturbing.
Okay, fine. It's certainly on. Yeah. Just a fan is on. Is it different now?
Yes, much better.
No, no.
When I wasn't, I didn't have a job.
Can somebody else take over?
I think Ramamurthy ji's this noise is, has not gone, Ramamurthy ji. It is still there.
Just a second.
No, it is still there, Ramamurthy ji. I think somebody else can speak in Hindi if anyone can.
Everything.
Or Ramamurthy ji, you can correct it and we can continue with the question answer session, and in the end he can give the summary.
Yeah, let me try to reconnect in that case. You can start question answer session. Let me try to reconnect. Yeah, okay, thank you. Yeah. I reconnect.
So there, like there were some questions in the chat. I can't see now.
They are there.
I mean, somebody I think will have to read from it and.
Or we can invite. There are actually some questions from Suhas ji. We can or. There is a question from Sujit that India was made of stratified society, but not the India in post-independence India, wherein the society, which is not based on caste structure too, was forced to merge. Please comment, was it really true that the education in pre-Macaulay period, that is pre-1835, was in mother tongue? If yes, whose mother tongue? Ms. Mayaji, would you like to comment on it?
Mayaji, you have to unmute yourself. Unmute yourself.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah. Before 1835, when schools were opened, lots of schools, missionary schools and other schools, used to impart education in regional languages. That is how, in fact, in Bengal, Kolkata, for instance, in Mumbai, the major cities, Kolkata, Mumbai, and Chennai, Madras at that time. Lots of schools were opened, and in fact, the missionary schools used mother tongues as the medium. And you see that Bible was translated into various regional languages as an activity of these. In fact, the government, British government, company Sarkar at that time used to take up programs for training their own officers in how to learn Indian languages, how to impart instruction in Indian languages, because there were lots of rules and regulations and, you know, things were being made anew. They didn't accept whatever was here. So, you know, for revenue collection, for taxes, for this, that, hazaro cheeze hoti thi. They were wanting to write these rules, and therefore learning the local languages was very important, because that is how the, in Pune, for instance, the Pune Patshala came into existence. All over the country, in fact, you know, wherever the missionaries reached, the British government was trying to establish its offices 1835 ke pehle. So lots of work was being done on mother tongue. You see, all the dictionaries in India, for instance, are around 1851. Molesworth, who's done such a wonderful job in Marathi, at least, for, you know, but there are all other, like the Kannada, Tamil, Bengali, lots of material from these, by way of dictionaries, grammar writing, that was happening in regional languages. Elphinstone, and I have got his educational records, where he says that mother tongues will be the greatest medium of instruction, because they can graft European knowledge on the Indian soil. They will be the easiest things to do, which policy, of course, later on changed with Macaulay, and English became the medium of instruction for all over, gradually, of course. But by 1858, you know, Mumbai University was established, and even courses on geography, chemistry, physics were given in Marathi. After first 2 years, the policy was stopped and English began to be used. In fact, 1836, a college was opened, medical college, Associated Grand Medical College. MacLennan's book on physiology was translated in Marathi at that time and taught to medical students. And today we say our languages, we can't do medical writing, engineering writing, etc. We haven't bothered. Elphinstone did to some extent. Yeah. Is that okay?
Yeah, it's fine. And you are very right. Actually, all those, even Punjabi, and there is interesting that Littner's study, that Punjab before company takeover was the largest educated, mm-hmm. but the question mother tongue at that time was acceptance of the state language.
Sure. Yes.
So that is to be added, and rightly, even we have a Punjabi English dictionary of 1850s.
And, absolutely, and interesting. Sir. Yes.
At one time, the dialects of Punjabi, there was a writing on dialects of Punjabi. Mm-hmm. And that was being taught to the officers so that they could understand, see? Actually. So that was their education for their ruling, not for mass education. We have to also understand they were not for good. Like
schools were now, very few only, no?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, now, even now they have right social justice, and they have reduced it to such a miserable thing that this is an era of human rights and social justice in a broader perspective where everyone's there. So thank you very much. Another question from Sujit is that he fully agrees that NEB 2020 is against the poor, tribal, downtrodden. Thank you for this. But do you think that we will see program of action later? Because it is now being implemented in full swing. To add to that, when Prime Minister says it is a people's policy, so that is already, there are instructions to the teachers, how would you implement it? Now it's not a program of action to come from the top. They are making people innovate this on that one. So
I think this is a question that only Javadekarji will be able to answer.
In fact, Usmania University had Urdu as a medium of instruction, even medicine and engineering.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Until 1950s, you know. Yes. And when I joined the school, 1950s, mm-hmm. so Urdu medium was just withdrawn and introduced Telugu medium as instruction. So, but doctors were produced through the Urdu medium, right?
Very
popular doctors. So perhaps Surjit doesn't know, but certain parts of India had mother tongue.
You are right, but I'm talking about the entire policy document for the whole country. Of course, states and then princely states had their own rules.
Yeah.
Hyderabad was a princely state.
So there's another comment that RT as a step from elite to egalitarianism, I think you mentioned it, will be grateful if you kindly elaborate it.
See, elitism is something which is only education only for the rich, for the upper class, for the upper castes. Egalitarian means going to the common people also, you know, taking education to common people in a good way, quality education. So they claim that this is from elitism to bilingual, taking it to ordinary people, but it's not so at all. In fact, ordinary people will be pushed again into the caste-specific structures, because where is the industrialization that demands different kinds of jobs in plenty? You know, there are only a few jobs available. What happens to people in, majority of people live in countryside, in rural India, where the caste structure dominates. Try Uttar Pradesh. What kind of options are you giving them? So, saying that early vocationalization means that after 11th, 12th, you will be straightway getting into jobs. And what jobs? In a country which is still not properly industrialized, leave alone a few cities here and there, there will be again huge migrations. And the jobs that will be available will only be caste-specific jobs. Carpentry seekho, lohar ka kaam seekho, jhadu marna seekho. That is what?
Maybe pakode banana bhi seekho. Maybe the Prime Minister said, "Pakode banana seekho."
Or gutter ke gas se cooking gas banana seekho.
So that innovation is there. So yes. Thank you.
Yeah.
Suhas Kolekar ji, aap.
हाँ मैं बात करना चाहूंगी. माया जी, आपने कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल वैल्यूज को थोड़ा टच किया, जो मैंने भी आर्टिकल लिखा उसमें मैंने मुद्दा किया था, और उसी के साथ दूसरा जो मुद्दा है तो शायद आप उस पे कमेंट करना चाहोगे क्या, कि एजुकेशन इज इन द कॉन्करेंट लिस्ट ऑफ स्टेट एंड center. There's this damn thing. There's no role of state. The letters are coming for implementation to the education secretaries directly from the center without even talking to the chief minister. So I am afraid that their action plan, if at all it comes, is all going to be directed to dismantling of democracy, dismantling of the entire secular structure, and just bringing autocracy and aadesh ka palan karne wale buddhu paida karna.
Sahi.
Nothing else.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I totally agree with you.
Yeah, so that's why it's more worrying than...
It's very worrying because you see, now they have said SCRT also, you know, along with NCERT. But they have said the NCERT will prepare all the curriculum and structure and the SCERT
That you did mention, so I didn't go for that. But in general, even the process of decision making, even the basic consultation, they just don't care. And with such a plurality of culture, geographical and linguistic and everything, it can never be one shirt fits all, as you said. So they
are only saying multilingual, multicultural, but there is nothing multilingual, nothing multicultural in this.
Yeah, so it is basically just Adesh Palan,
Adesh
RSS agenda, nothing else to be
true.
One word.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Jagmohanji, can I
sure.
say something? Yeah, it's excellent. Deliberation. I'm really happy to listen to Mayaji. It's wonderful. In fact, the first quarter, I was a little bit critical, but the third, fourth, and three-fourth of the whole portion was so exciting that I started becoming a good, very, very heartfelt fan of you. And
I'm sorry, I bored you so in the exciting. Earlier parts.
My network today is so bad that there were some disconnection problem. And when the Hindi translation was going on, again, I was disconnected. And when I rejoined again, it was already, you have answered my question. So I miss it. I'll see it in the Facebook. I want to be a little bit blunt. It's not to you exactly, but whenever we talk about India, we all the time have a notion that India, one issue is caste system. Definitely it is. But then in the spirit of diversity and the plurality, even if one person is not covered within that, I wish that we must cover that as well.
I totally agree with you. Yeah. I had time constraints. So, you know, some of these
issues. I know.
Like, for instance, I mentioned Nagaland, Mizoram, etc. You know, many parts I did mention, many parts I didn't mention also. But, you know, each part of India is so full of cultural, linguistic, religious diversity, their own... you know, special points. It's very difficult to go into all that, you know, in such a small...
And,
next time I'll take it to account.
Another thing is that, of course, if a choice is given to me, the dharmic values and the values of what we call eternal Indian values and the constitutional values, if the choice is given to me, definitely I will choose for Constitution of India.
Yeah,
but actually, at least in the spirit of scientific approach and the scientific department, which is in fact inbuilt in the Constitution, even the constitutional values are to be under scrutiny for creating a new India, because even our constitutions, the kind of the federalism that the constitution is promoting is not at all the kind of the federalism that India can survive. So within that spirit, NEP 2020 is in fact perhaps an eye-opener for us that India cannot survive even with the present constitutional framework, because within the constitutional framework, the policy was approved, and within this constitutional framework, it has been implemented even without discussing in the parliament. So even the
there you are wrong, sir. It was discussed threadbare. Nehru and Ambedkar faced a lot of opposition from
I'm talking about the NEP. I'm talking about the NEP 2020.
NEP you're talking about.
NEP, this form was not discussed. This 65-page document was non-discussed.
I'm referring to the NEP 2020.
Parliament, you tell me.
Yes. So
I agree. Yes.
So allowing to implement even without a declaration to implement the NEP 2020 is still, we don't have, I don't know, do we have a hope to intervene this one by Supreme Court? I'm really not very sure about it. But
for your information, I must add one more point, you know, because before NEP 2020 was published as the policy, they had put it on the network, you know, some kind of a rough draft. And they had invited comments and corrections and suggestions from many people. Though it was not put in the parliament, as you very rightly say, it was not discussed, but they had invited some suggestions. And I think the emphasis on Hindu religion was a little bit lessened after, you know, in that rough draft and this draft, if you compare, you find that it's a little diluted, little, not much. Because basically it is a Hindu framework. That is my idea.
Yeah, I do agree. But then seeing the way some wrong things can be implemented even without discussing in the parliament, still the constitution...
Like the farmers' bills, no.
Yeah.
Like the farmers' bills. No, no discussion, right. Nothing. Like the GST, no discussion. Just implement. Like the, you know, anti-workers...
This is not the constitutional way. So...
No, I still believe that when something can do it in this manner, then perhaps it is also constitutional.
This is autocracy.
If it is not constitutional, then how can it be possible?
This is the autocratic way. That's what I was pointing out.
They are not following
the constitution. That's why in the we had raised this in our Janta Parliament process, and when whatever reduced form the Sansad happened, I had sent some questions to be asked through the through that process, in which I had asked that whatever responses they had asked, have they put it in the public domain? They haven't. But they haven't answered the questions also.
They are not following
the democratic process. They are not following the constitution.
Yeah, I fully agree that it's
basically criminal.
In the right spirit of the constitution, we can say criminal, we can say many things, but things are happening. And this is the most unfortunate things. And
so we all have to protest together.
The point is they do not want the constitution, they do not want socialist secular India, they want a Hindu India. And all this is in preparation of that.
Yeah, then I fully agree. But then
we have to collectively protest.
I'm referring from the standpoint of the strategy. When we say NEP 2020, we disagree, inherently education and the concurrent list must be reversed back to the state subject. I'm just giving one example. So even re-examining once again the constitution in the light of the what is happening with the NEP 2020 today must be at least a part of the, our strategy for fight. This is what I'm proposing. The whole notion that constitution is so good, so sacrosanct, if it is done in the spirit of the constitution, everything will be okay, is something that we need to ponder upon. Yeah, this is what I'm saying.
Yeah, otherwise, their answer is, you know, kharish karo ye constitution, naya constitution Hindu rashtra ka banao. That is the answer to your question.
But as a strategy, Surjit, though I agree with your point, as a strategy, at this moment, we shouldn't say it in these terms. Because they want it to be said and they will bring the Manuvadi constitution for you.
We'll reject that. We will reject NEP as much as Manuvadi.
No one is listening to you for that.
Yeah.
They're already doing it.
Yeah.
Okay, let us.
But then if we really argue it.
Am I audible, sir? Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
I have two. Should I translate first?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Sure. Okay, fair. Hindi mein questions hai.
तो मैं आप सबके समय नष्ट करने के लिए माफी चाहूंगा क्योंकि नेटवर्क का मुद्दा मेरे हाथ में नहीं था तो मैं उसके लिए कुछ खास नहीं कर सका. अब मैं मुख्य रूप से जो माया जी ने बातें कही उनमें से कुछ का जिक्र इस तरह से. सबसे पहले तो उन्होंने हमें ये समझाने की कोशिश की कि नीति होती क्या है. मुख्य रूप से किसी विषय कोई नीति बनाई जाए वो उसकी कुछ व्यवस्थाएं होती हैं, कुछ उपव्यवस्था होती हैं, और उन व्यवस्थाओं को लागू करने के लिए कुछ नियम बनाए जाते हैं, और उन नियमों के साथ साथ उसका एक विस्तृत विवेचन होता है कि इनको लागू करने के लिए कौन कौन सा ढांचा बनाया जाएगा, ढांचे में क्या परिवर्तन किया जाएगा। एक तो उन्होंने ये हमें नीति का मतलब समझाने, और दूसरा उन्होंने कहा कि हर एक नीति का एक परिप्रेक्ष्य होता है जो और एक परिकल्पना होती है। तो उनकी परिकल्पना यह है कि ये नीति जो पिछड़ों का विकास है उसको किस तरह से देखती है, नीति में जो दबे कुचले तबके हैं उनके विकास की बात किस तरह से की गई है, और विशेष रूप से टीचर जो है जो उनको किस तरह से देखा गया है उसको उन्होंने एक प्रमुख बिंदु अपनी विवेचना चर्चा कर रखा है। फिर उसके बाद उन्होंने जो ऐतिहासिक परिप्रेक्ष्य में थोड़ा सा संक्षेप में एक विश्लेषण किया कि इतिहास भारत में शिक्षा का इतिहास क्या रहा है, मुख्य रूप से वैदिक समय से लेकर औपनिवेशिक काल तक के सभी आयामों का उन्होंने संक्षेप में जिक्र करते हुए ये कहा कि जो तथाकथित वैदिक व्यवस्था थी उसमें केवल ऋचाओं के पाठ या उनके सीखने की बात की जाती थी जो कि ब्राह्मणों द्वारा ही की जाती थी। उसकी तुलना में जो बौद्धिक शिक्षण व्यवस्था बुद्धकालीन शिक्षा व्यवस्था थी वो ज्यादा लोकतांत्रिक थी, बुद्धों की शिक्षा बिहार में होती थी जिसमें लोगों की भागीदारी ज्यादा थी, जिसके बारे में काफी सारे यात्रियों ने बहुत विस्तार से लिखा है। उस लोकतांत्रिकता को हमें बिल्कुल याद रखना चाहिए। फिर उन्होंने कहा कि बुद्धों के पतन के बाद विशेष रूप से 8वीं शताब्दी के बाद ये जो मनुवादी ब्राह्मणवादी व्यवस्था है एक बार पुनः हावी होती है, और उस तरह से जो ब्राह्मणवादी व्यवस्था में बाकी चीजों के साथ साथ शिक्षा का भी चतुरंगिक वर्णीकरण कर दिया जाता है कि चार रंगों का जो वर्ण व्यवस्था है उसको सारी समाज के ऊपर थोप दिया जाता है, शिक्षा को भी इसमें शामिल कर जाता। जब हम चार वर्णों और कामों की बात करते हैं इसके संदर्भ में ये विशेष रूप से उल्लेख कि जो आत्मा वर्ण जिसे अति शूद्र वर्ण कहा गया उसे तो मनुष्य ब्राह्मणवादी व्यवस्था ने उचित नहीं समझा, उसे माना गया ये तो मनुष्य के हैं, और बाकी चार वर्णों के काम उन्होंने मनुवादी व्यवस्था के आधारित किए। ब्राह्मणों का काम जो है धार्मिक काम करना है, क्षत्रियों का काम जो है लड़ाई करना है बैठना, और शूद्रों को उन सबकी सेवा करना है, और अति शूद्रों को सेवा के काम से जरूर जोड़ा गया लेकिन उन्हें मनुष्य तो कभी नहीं माना गया। फिर वो मध्यकालीन समय जैसे मुसलमान जो क्या मुसलमानों में उसकी बात मुख्य रूप से दो प्रावधान थे कि मकताब और मदरसा होते थे, मकताब थे उच्च शिक्षा के केंद्र थे जिसमें मुख्य रूप से उर्दू और फारसी भाषी शिक्षा दी जाती थी, और मदरसे जो थे वो उनमें एक तरह से धार्मिक और प्रारंभिक लेवल की शिक्षा दी जाती थी जो कि मस्जिदों से तय जुड़े होते थे। और उन्होंने कहा कि बहुत सारे लोग मतलब गैर मुस्लिम लोग भी मदरसों और मकताबों में जाके शिक्षा हासिल करते थे क्योंकि उनको काम की उसमें काफी सारी चीजें थे, विशेष रूप से वो फारसी से कई ऐसे हुनर सिखाते थे जिन्हें लोग बाद में मुनीमी वगैरह के काम के लिए इस्तेमाल करते थे, जो लेखा जोखा रखने वाला एक तरह की व्यापारियों या दुकानदारों की क्लर्की करने वाले लोग होते थे, उनके वो काम के होते थे तो वो उन चीजों को सीखते थे। फिर औपनिवेशिक काल की बात जब आती है तो उन्होंने कहा कि अंग्रेजों ने जो मुख्य रूप से बदलाव किए उसे मुख्य रूप से उच्च जातियों को लाभ हुआ और उच्च जातियों ने बड़ी तेजी से उसको अपनाया। तो मुख्य परिवर्तनों में उन्होंने जिक्र किया कि जैसे 1813 का जो चार्टर एक्ट था उसमें 1,00,000 रुपया रखा गया जिसको कि भारतीय साहित्य को विकास करने के लिए खर्च किया जाना था, और उसके नाम पे कुछ चीजें विकसित हुई। फिर जिक्र किया कि किस तरह से आंग्लवादियों और पूर्वात्यवादियों में एंग्लिसिस्ट और ओरिएंटलिस्ट के बीच में जो बहस हुई और जिसका नतीजा अंत में मैकाले ने यह निकाला कि उन्होंने जो आंग्लवादी हैं उनकी एक तरह से तरफदारी करते हुए माध्यम को अंग्रेजी कर दिया, मतलब सीखने का या पढ़ने पढ़ाने का माध्यम अंग्रेजी को निर्धारित कर दिया गया मेकाले के मंच के द्वारा, फिर बुक डिस्पैच के द्वारा एक तरह से शिक्षा की एक रूपता की आपने बात कही, जिसमें कि स्कूल अधिक मात्रा में शुरू किए गए, विश्वविद्यालय भी शुरू किए गए, और जिसे भारतीय शिक्षा का मैग्ना कार्टा कहा जाता है उसका जिक्र किया, किस तरह से उन्होंने जो संस्कृति की विविधता मतलब शिक्षा की विविधता थी उसके स्थान पर उसकी एक रूपता की तरफ उसको बढ़ाने की बात की, और ये जो समूची एक रूपता की बात थी कुल मिला के उच्च जातियों की पक्षधरता के ऊपर आधारित थी, क्योंकि इससे ज्यादातर जो चीजें प्रस्तावित थी वो उनकी उपलब्धता उच्च जातियों के लिए ज्यादा थी, और पूरी मतलब इसके बाद 1854 से 1947 के बाद कई सारे बदलावों के साथ मूल रूप से ये ढांचा जारी रहा, और भारतीय जब स्वतंत्रता के बाद भारतीय सरकार ने शिक्षा में बदलाव की बात की तो उन्होंने मुख्य रूप से इसी ढांचे को अपनाए रखा, इसमें छोटे मोटे बदलाव किए लेकिन आमूल बदलाव की बात नहीं की। फिर आप जिक्र करते हैं मुख्य रूप से यूनिवर्सिटी आयोग जिसे हम राधा कृष्ण आयोग कहते हैं, जिसमें उन्होंने कहा था कि शिक्षा की उपलब्धता की कोशिश सभी के लिए की जानी चाहिए और ऐसा सुनिश्चित किया जाए कि ज्यादा से ज्यादा लोग विश्वविद्यालयों में आए, और उन्होंने किस तरह से संवैधानिक और लोकतांत्रिक मूल्यों की बात की थी विश्वविद्यालय आयोग में उसकी बात की। फिर मुदालियर कमीशन जो आयोग था जिसमें बहुउद्देश्य विद्यालयों की बात की गई थी या एक विविधता आधारित विद्यालयों की बात की गई थी उसका उन्होंने जिक्र किया, और उस पर आते आते वो कुठारी आयोग की रिपोर्ट पे आते हैं जिसके मुख्य रूप से वो चार चीजों की तरफ इशारा करते हैं। एक तो इसमें व्यक्तित्व विकास कल्याण और सुरक्षा के ऊपर मतलब व्यक्तित्व विकास जन कल्याण और व्यक्तिगत या सामूहिक सुरक्षा के ऊपर तीन चीजों की बात की गई, और शिक्षा को एक सामाजिक बदलाव में औजार के रूप में देखा गया उसको ध्यान में रखते हुए उन्होंने कुछ प्रस्ताव किए, और चौथी चीज पहली बार आधिकारिक रूप से तीन भाषाओं का जो सूत्र है त्रिभाषिक फार्मूला जिसे हम कहते हैं उसे लागू किया गया, जिसका उद्देश्य ये था कि लोगों मतलब मुख्य रूप से अलग अलग राज्यों के लोगों के बीच में जो है एक एकता में विविधता को स्थापित करने की कोशिश की जाए, और लोग अलग अलग राज्यों की भाषाओं को भी सीखें और अंग्रेजी या विदेशी भाषा के साथ एक कोई ऐसी भाषा सीखें, हिंदी भी जिसमें शामिल थी, और जो संविधान की अनुसूची की 8वीं अनुसूची की अन्य भाषाएं भी थी। बहरहाल उसके बाद फिर जब 1986 में आते हैं तो उसमें उनका मानना है कि कुछ ऐसे बदलाव हुए जिन्होंने आज की नीति की जो है एक तरह से नींव रखी, और आज जो हम समस्याएं देखते हैं उनकी जड़ कुछ हद तक जो 1986 की नीति में प्रस्तावित निजीकरण के कुछ आयाम है उनमें हम देख सकते हैं। लेकिन 1986 की नीति की कुछ खास अच्छी बातें भी थी, जैसे उसमें कुछ समूहों के शैक्षणिक विकास पर विशेष रूप से जोर था, उनके लिए आगे जाकर प्रोग्राम ऑफ एक्शन में कुछ प्रावधान भी थे जिनमें विशेष रूप से अनुसूचित जाति अनुसूचित जनजाति महिलाएं विकलांग और प्रौढ़ शिक्षा के जो है वो क्षेत्र मुख्य रूप से उल्लेखनीय थे, और इन सब के लिए उन्होंने कुछ योजनाएं भी बनाई थी, और इसके साथ साथ जो उन्होंने उस समय नॉन अनौपचारिक शिक्षा या पार्ट टाइम शिक्षा या राष्ट्रीय खुले बोर्डों द्वारा शिक्षा देने जैसे प्रावधान किए उसका भोग अभी भी हम कर रहे हैं, क्योंकि इसने एक तरह से सीधा विभेदीकरण शुरू कर दिया, और खासतौर पर नवोदय विद्यालय जैसे एक विशेष वर्ग के लिए खोले जाने वाले स्कूल इस संदर्भ में विभेदीकरण के संदर्भ में उल्लेखनीय उदाहरण है। इसके बाद फिर इन्होंने जिक्र किया जो DPEP 1992 का प्रोग्राम ऑफ एक्शन, उसके बाद जिला शिक्षा प्राथमिक कार्यक्रम, सर्व शिक्षा अभियान वगैरह के साथ आते आते लगातार किस तरह से ये विभेदीकरण बढ़ता गया और निजीकरण को बढ़ावा देते गए, जिसके उन्होंने बहुत सारे उदाहरणों के साथ बात की कि किस तरह से निजीकरण को महाराष्ट्र जैसे राज्य में अंग्रेजी माध्यम से जो है ये कहा गया कि पहली कक्षा से अंग्रेजी आप पढ़ाई जाए, जिसके लिए शिक्षक भी तैयार नहीं थे और विद्यार्थी भी तैयार नहीं थे, केवल ऐसे लोगों को वो गीत सुनाने की बात थी जिन्हें ना उसका गीत का कोई अंदाजा था और ना ही वो उसकी शब्दावली को समझते थे, तो इस तरह से ये निजीकरण का एक असर हुआ और निजीकरण की प्रक्रिया आपका कहना है कि 1980 के उत्तरार्ध से शुरू होती है, जिसको बढ़ते बढ़ते आज हम बहुत विकराल रूप देख रहे हैं। तो शुरू से ही उसका चरित्र यही रहा है कि लोगों से महंगी महंगी फीस लेना और उन्हें बदले में कुछ नहीं देना और सजावट की चीजें दिखा के लोगों को लुभाना, जहां पे ये बड़े संस्थाओं या बड़े स्तर पे संभव नहीं है वहां ऐसा करने के लिए बहुत ही बुरे ढंग से चलाए जाने वाले अंग्रेजी स्कूल खोले गए, जिनके संचालकों शिक्षकों किसी को भी अंग्रेजी नहीं आती और केवल वो उसको प्रमाण देने की कोशिश करते हैं। बहरहाल फिर वो जिक्र 2009 के शिक्षा अधिकार अधिनियम का भी करते हैं, जिसे उन्होंने कहा कि अभिजात से समता मूलक शिक्षा की ओर कदम था, वो सिर्फ इस सेंस में कि काफी सारे लोगों को उसके माध्यम से शिक्षा में जो है दाखिल होने का मौका मिला, जो शायद अन्यथा नहीं मिल रहा था। और सरकार के ऊपर कुछ बाध्यताएं हुई कि उन्होंने शिक्षा जो है शिक्षा को नियोजित करने के लिए कुछ नियम बनाए। अब वो आते हैं 1915 पे एक महत्वपूर्ण दस्तावेज पे, जिसके आधार पे और जिसके साथ कुछ अन्य दस्तावेजों के आधार पे असल में ये NEP 2020 जो नई शिक्षा नीति है वो आधारित है, वो दस्तावेज है जो सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल यानी के एक जो टिकाऊ विकास के 2030 के उद्देश्य हैं। तो उन्होंने कहा कि संयुक्त राष्ट्र संघ के नाम पर दुनिया के देशों ने कुछ देशों की निश्चित तौर पे कुछ देशों और उनकी संस्थाओं की अगुवाई में 2015 में एक दस्तावेज बनाया जिसको कहा गया सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल 2030 यानी कि 2030 तक प्राप्त किए जाने वाले जो टिकाऊ विकास है उसके उद्देश्य। तो उन्होंने कहा कुल मिला के इसका जो शीर्षक था बहुत आकर्षक था कि बदल बेहतरी के लिए परिवर्तित विश्व के उद्देश्य, कि मतलब दुनिया को बेहतर बनाने के लिए हमने कौन सा विश्व जो है वो तैयार करना है, उसके उद्देश्य क्या है। तो उसमें उन्होंने कहा कि कुल मिला के 17 उद्देश्य थे, जिसमें वातावरण से संबंधित था, असमानता को दूर करने की बात की गई थी और एक नए विश्व व्यवस्था बनाने की बात की गई थी, और इसमें चौथे नंबर पे शिक्षा को जो है सभी के लिए शिक्षा का जो है वो गोल उद्देश्य रखा गया था, जो 17 उद्देश्यों की सूची में चौथे नंबर पे था। अब वो उसकी थोड़ा विस्तार से बात करते हैं और उसकी एक तरह से उसको समानांतर रूप से देखते हैं कि जो शिक्षा नीति 2020 की शिक्षा नीति है उसके और इसकी भाषा और ये बिंदु किस तरह से बिल्कुल एक दूसरे के साथ मिलते हैं, और उसमें उन्होंने साथ में फिर किस तरह से हिंदुत्व का या तथाकथित जो ब्राह्मण तथाकथित नहीं वास्तव में ही वो ब्राह्मणवादी जो हिंदुत्व की धारणा है उसको किस तरह से उसमें जोड़ दिया है। मसलन अगर आप शिक्षा नीति के दस्तावेज के जो परिचय मतलब इंट्रोडक्शन वाला हिस्सा है उसमें आप पढ़ेंगे तो पहले हिस्से में आपको जो टिकाऊ विकास के उद्देश्य हैं उनकी एक झलक मिलेगी, जिसमें पैटागोजी ऑफ लर्निंग सीखने की शिक्षा की बात की गई है, इंक्वायरी ड्रिवन एजुकेशन गवेषणा पे आधारित शिक्षा की बात की गई है, साइंटिफिक टेम्पर वैज्ञानिक जो है वो सोच की बात मिलेगी, और उसके साथ साथ आपको मिलेगा आलोचनात्मक चिंतन क्रिटिकल थिंकिंग या आलोचनात्मक सोच की बात मिलेगी। लेकिन उसके साथ एक यू टर्म के साथ ही आता है एंशंट एंड इंटरनल थिंकिंग वैल्यू, जो मतलब भारत के प्राचीन और शाश्वत मूल्य हैं जो हमें नैतिकता की ओर गाइड करते हैं, उनको लगातार हम सिखाना चाहेंगे। अब उससे पहले माया जी सवाल उठाती हैं कि अगर आप तो शिक्षा को डायनेमिक मानते हैं तो वो शाश्वत कैसे हो सकती है, और एंशंट का क्या मतलब है? एंशंट प्राचीन का मतलब केवल उनका बहुविध जो हमारे प्राचीन संस्कृतियां हैं उनसे बिल्कुल नहीं है, या बहुविध जो प्रचलन में अलग अलग क्षेत्रों के जो एक तरह के आयाम हैं वो नहीं है, बल्कि प्राचीनता से उनका मतलब गंगा यमुनी मैदान का वो हिंदू भाग जिसमें कुछ लोग रहते थे उनका हिस्सा उसमें मूल्यों की वो बात करते हैं। तो ये जो है बिल्कुल ही आज के लिए असंगत है, बिल्कुल असंगत है। और आज का भारत गंगा यमुनी मैदानों का हिंदू भारत नहीं, वो बहुत सांस्कृतिक बहुलतावादी भारत है। फिर वो आगे इसके बारे में विस्तार से एनईपी के संदर्भ में चर्चा करते हैं, और ये संदर्भ उन्होंने तीन चार उदाहरणों से विशेष रूप से उभारा। मसलन वो ये बात करते हैं कि जब इसमें मूल्यों की बात की गई है, तो मूल्यों में संवैधानिक मूल्य जो है हमारे स्वतंत्रता, समानता, भ्रातृत्व, इनको बिल्कुल आखिर में रखा गया है। इनकी ज्यादा जोर किस कैसे मूल्यों पे है, जो हिंदूवादी ग्रंथों के मूल्य हैं, जिसमें सेवा, उसका त्याग, निष्काम सेवा, निष्काम कर्म करना, दूसरों की जो है देखभाल करना, धार्मिक जिम्मेदारी निभाना, कर्तव्य परायणता वगैरह वगैरह, कई ऐसे मूल्यों का लब्बो लुबाब ये निकलता है कि ये जातिवादी वर्ण व्यवस्था, जातिवादी ढांचे को बनाए रखने के लिए करते हैं, जिससे कि आप एक तरह से एक आपको भावनात्मक रूप से इस बात की ओर प्रेरित किया जा सके और निर्भर किया है कि आपका काम तो सेवा करना ही है, और आप आलोचनात्मक चिंतन का वैज्ञानिक सोच की बात सोच के या बराबरी की सोच सोच के तथा जो उनकी जाती है उनके बराबर सोचने का स्वप्न भी मत देखें, बल्कि आप अपने आप को ये सोचें कि आपका काम उनकी सेवा करना है, और आप अपने आप को मानसिक रूप से अधीनस्थ स्थिति में बनाए रखने के लिए तैयार रखें। ये इनके जो मूल्य सिस्टम है उसका उद्देश्य है। फिर उन्होंने दूसरी बात की, विशेष रूप से इस समूची व्यवस्था के ढांचे की चर्चा करते हुए, जिसमें बाल वाटिका से लेकर 12वीं तक की शिक्षा के 5 जमा 3 जमा 3 जमा 4 की बात की गई है। इसके संदर्भ में उन्होंने कहा कि इसमें तीन चार चीजें हमें मुख्य रूप से बड़ी स्पष्ट रूप से दिखती हैं। एक तो जो अर्ली इंट्रोडक्शन टू वोकेशनल एजुकेशन है, मतलब छोटी कक्षाओं में व्यावसायिक शिक्षा का जो प्रयोजन है, इसका मुख्य मकसद लोगों को सिर्फ और सिर्फ जातिगत व्यवसायों की तरफ धकेलना है। सुनार का लड़का सुनार बना रहे, सुतार का लड़का सुतार बना रहे, ये उन्होंने हिंदी में भी उदाहरण बोला, तो इसका मतलब यही है कि आप उस व्यवस्था को टिकाए रखना चाहते हैं, और उस व्यवस्था के माध्यम से जो कमजोर जातियों, कमजोर वर्गों के लोग हैं, उनको शिक्षा से केवल प्राथमिक या माध्यमिक कक्षाओं में बाहर निकाल देना चाहते हैं, ताकि वो नहीं सेवा शिशु शिक्षा से काम में व्यवसायों में लगे रहे। दूसरा उन्होंने महत्वपूर्ण बात भाषाओं के संदर्भ में कही कि भाषाओं में त्रिभाषी उपचार मूल्य की बात की गई है, लेकिन सारा जोर हिंदी और को लागू करने के ऊपर दिया गया है। तो वो सवाल उठाते हैं कि संस्कृत को इतना जो है इतना महत्व क्यों, जबकि इसे बहुत कम लोग बोलते हैं और बहुत कम लोगों की ये समझी जाती है। तो आपका मानना है कि संस्कृत मुख्य रूप से इसलिए कि इससे ब्राह्मणवादी व्यवस्था को टिकाए रखा जा सके और ब्राह्मणों और ऊंची जातियों का जो वर्चस्व है उसको स्थापित किया जाए। उन्होंने कई उदाहरणों से ये बात कहने की कोशिश की कि संविधान की 8वीं सूची की सभी भाषाओं को बराबर का महत्व क्यों नहीं, और विशेष रूप से जो अलग अलग स्थानों पर बोलियां बोली जाती हैं उनको महत्व क्यों नहीं, जैसे कि महाराष्ट्र का उन्होंने उदाहरण दिया कि जहाँ 7 से अधिक ऐसी बोलियां हैं जो व्यापक क्षेत्र में बोली जाती हैं, तो अगर आप इन्हें सिखाने के लिए पर्याप्त प्रबंध करेंगे तो आप काफ़ी सारे शिक्षक चाहिए होंगे जो इन भाषाओं बोलियों को जानते हों, उसके लिए साहित्य भी तैयार करना पड़ेगा, जिसके लिए नीचे तैयार नहीं है। तो इसी तरह से ये जो तीन भाषाओं का फार्मूला है, ये मुख्य रूप से केवल लोगों को शिक्षा के दायरे से कमजोर वर्गों को बाहर निकालने और हिंदी और संस्कृत को लोगों के ऊपर थोपने की परियोजना है। और तो सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल टिकाऊ विकास के एजेंडे को पुख्ता करते हुए लगते हैं, और वो केंद्रीकरण, वाणिज्यिक या व्यापारीकरण और फिर सांप्रदायिककरण। केंद्रीकरण के तहत उन्होंने कई उदाहरणों से कहा कि आप UGC और NCTE नेशनल काउंसिल ऑफ टीचर एजुकेशन जैसी संस्थाओं को इतना केंद्रीकृत कर देना चाहते हैं कि आपको लगता है कि सारी चीजें केंद्र से ही शुरू होनी चाहिए और केंद्र के आदेश के बिना किसी भी चीज को आगे नहीं बढ़ाया जाना चाहिए, जो कि भारतीय संविधान के संघीय भावना से बिल्कुल विपरीत है और इसका विरोध पूरी तरह से बढ़ाना चाहिए। तीसरी, उन्होंने विशेष रूप से वाणिज्यकरण की बात की, जिसके विभिन्न उदाहरण पहले भी उन्होंने दिए कि किस तरह से निजीकरण से जो है लोग प्रॉफिट कमाने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं, और इस संदर्भ में ये रोचक है कि इसका नाम बदल के अब उसको सार्वजनिक और परोपकारी परोपकार की भावना से प्रेरित लोगों की साझेदारी कहा जाए, यानी कि पब्लिक एंड फिलोसॉफिक फिलोसॉफिक पार्टनरशिप का जो नाम है उससे हिंदी में अगर हम कहें तो सार्वजनिक और परोपकारी भावना से प्रेरित लोगों की भागीदारी है। तो आपने सवाल उठाया कि कोई भी व्यापारी जो है वो किस तरह से परोपकारी हो सकता है कुछ लोगों से जोड़ के। ज़्यादातर लोगों ने ये इतिहास गवाया है कि शिक्षा से पैसा कमाया है और उससे वो और अमीर हुए हैं, तो उनसे ये उम्मीद करना कि वो बहुत परोपकारी होके केवल लोगों की भलाई के लिए शिक्षा के ऊपर खर्च करेंगे, मतलब जो है सच्चाई से मुंह मोड़ना है और अपने आप को बेवकूफ बनाना है, ये कभी भी नहीं होने लगा होने वाला। इसका मुद्दा उन्होंने सांप्रदायिकरण की बात की, लोगों को धर्म के आधार पर बांटना, जिसके उदाहरण हम रोजमर्रा देख सकते हैं। फिर इसी तरह से उन्होंने उच्च शिक्षा के संदर्भ में उसकी व्याख्या करते हुए मुख्य रूप से ये कहा कि आप विभेद मतलब एक बहुपक्षीय व्यवस्था क्यों स्थापित करना चाहते हैं, क्यों आप कुछ विश्वविद्यालय को आदर्श विश्वविद्यालय के रूप में स्थापित करना चाहते हो, क्यों कुछ ही विश्वविद्यालयों को शोध विद्यालयों के रूप में विकसित करना चाहते हो, जिसका मतलब है कि बाकी विश्वविद्यालय जो है उनको आप कबाड़ के रूप में परिवर्तित कर दें और उनका कोई मतलब नहीं रह जाएगा, उन्हें आप पैसे भी नहीं देंगे। इसी तरह से जिले स्तर पर जो यूनिवर्सिटियाँ खोलने की बात है, वो यूनिवर्सिटी खोलना अच्छी बात है, लेकिन उसका परिणाम ये निकलेगा कि जो अभी तक कई जिलों में अलग अलग स्थानों पर छोटे छोटे कॉलेज खुले हुए थे, जिसमें कमजोर वर्गों के लोग और दिन जो बहुत दूर नहीं जा सकते वो शिक्षा खासतौर पर लड़कियाँ शिक्षा प्राप्त करती थी, तो उनके लिए मॉडल बंद हो जाएगा, क्योंकि बहुत सारे जगह पर जिला मुख्यालय जो है वो काफी है और सबके लिए संभव होगा। उन्होंने इसको समझाने की कोशिश की, मुख्य रूप से एक तो हमारा संप्रदायीकरण कर रहे हैं, लोग बहिष्कृत कर रहे हैं, केवल शिक्षा नीति गरीबों को शिक्षा से और दूर करना।
आवाज आपकी
दो
मिनट,
हेलो अब आ रही है सर,
अब बस फिनिश कर दीजिए ताकि हम लास्ट क्वेश्चन।
जी बात जी बिल्कुल, तो अंत में उन्होंने यही कहा कि इस शिक्षा नीति का मुख्य उद्देश्य शिक्षा गरीबों को शिक्षा से वंचित करना है, इसके अलावा कुछ नहीं है, ये केवल साजिश है गरीबों के खिलाफ, मजदूरों के खिलाफ, किसानों के खिलाफ, उन सब मेहनत कशों के साथ जो अपनी मेहनत से कुछ करना चाहते हैं। धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू राममूर्ति जी, एज यूजुअल यू मेड ए वंडरफुल नॉट समरी बट क्वाइट एलैबोरेटिव हिंदी ट्रांसलेशन ऑफ प्रोफेसर माया पंडित जी। But there's a one Hindi question which I just, and that will be the last question on this. There is a Vikas Mani ji. He, main Hindi mein bol dun ab?
Haan haan. Main Hindi mein try karungi. Bilkul.
So Vikas Mani ji ne kaha hai ki actually loktantar to us wakt bik gaya jab log part mal muddon pe vote nahi karte aur matdan jo hai wo muddon pe nahi hota. तो सारा ध्यान केंद्रित वो करते हैं परिणामों पर और उसमें बाकी सारे पर। तो उन्होंने जो लास्ट कमेंट दिया कि सरकारी नीति जो है वो विश्व गुरु बनाने की नहीं है, वो तो छात्रों को विश्व मजदूरों की फौज बनाने की है। तो
आई कम्प्लीटली एग्री, नहीं ये तो यही बात है, वो बिल्कुल इसेंस उन्होंने पकड़ लिया है, ये इसमें क्वेश्चन है ही नहीं एक्चुअली। तो मैं ये मत से पूरी तरह से सहमत हूँ कि हाँ हम कोई विश्वगुरु नहीं होंगे, हम कामगार होंगे, एक बड़ी फौज तैयार करके दुनिया के लिए रखेंगे कि भाई आओ इनका इस्तेमाल करो, हमारा कुछ अच्छा होने वाला नहीं है।
थैंक यू
सर।
तो लास्ट माय duty to thank you as a chairperson of the All India Forum for Right to Education. And I think it was a wonderful presentation and very illuminating. And one idea which came to me was that 1986 education policy was preparing India for broad new liberal agenda. And this is sail out to the new liberal policies, because there is a parallel World Bank policy of strategy of education 2020. And that is what adopted by Pakistan also. So
we'll all be caught in the net.
Yeah. So yes. So that is, and now it occurs to me that post 47, we were in a process of decolonization. Kothari report could be one where we attempted to decolonize, and now it is virtually recolonization with all the other flavors added. That people will, that you are very rightly pointed out that the social justice is a much broader issue. I think 21st century has to be the century of social justice. It means equality, liberty, fraternity, and justice, and to everyone.
Yes.
And now they are pronouncing it as a empire of maybe first century. And I very interestingly found how the copycat has been done.
Yes.
One time they are using BC, before Christ. Next line is BCE, the before common era. Well, another term, and then they write AD. Well, I don't know, they could not synchronize.
Yeah, copy paste karne mein bhi akal nahi lagai.
So thank you very much, and I think it was a very enlightening and giving us that challenge that we have to really stand. So Hazri keh rahi thi, we have to stand together and stand strongly, because somebody commented ke nobody is listening, why we are talking?
No, I think that is
most important. When nobody is listening, we have to make them listen. Like in Punjab, the farmers, women, yes, and children, and young people have made the at least political parties in Punjab to listen, and that is the voice. And this
absolutely
is, education is for everybody's good, because if really want, and then they are actually preparing. Sometime back, I think he forgot, Prime Minister, that he was talking of fourth industrial revolution meant that you have to prepare for AI. You have to, and now you will be virtually what you are doing, and they called it a fourth wave of information. But the only thing is, I went to a computer shop today because some good girls were to be presented a computer. He said our business has doubled in this period of, I said you must be bad. No, you know, he said our business has doubled in this, and that is what it is. This is virtually selling technology, and all of us feel how bad the connection is. The more secure we feel, and we are struggling, how would the students will be doing it? So I think bringing all these points of social justice, and you're rightly, from the perspective of a teacher, it is much more important. How would he face it? Because, and then the teachers are not given any kind of social protection. They are virtually made more unprotected, which will virtually mean that we used to have a story earlier when British also at the last end has a Victoria Jubilee School. My first primary school was VJ Primary School in my village. And then the teachers were given 40 rupees to teach. And somebody was teaching G.I.R. Gill. He said, somebody educated past, and he said, Master Ji, G.I.R. Girl to padha do. Wo kehta ji, in 40 rupees, you can only teach Gill. So I think from teacher's perspective, we are really going to have, which you also shared, that how about those teachers who themselves are not, so will do it. So thank you very much, Mayaji. You really added to our this series, and we hope we will continue with building an alternative for people, which can give them, because education is something which cannot be postponed. It has to be done when it is required. And then, as you said, girls will be the last sufferer when they will make big schools, big institutions away from their place. They will never be, because the whole institute is there. So thank you very much from heart. From
thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, all of you.
And for our listeners, this talk will be available by tomorrow morning on our YouTube channel also, where it permanently will be there. So people can visit it and raise your suggestions, questions, and suggestions. How do we move ahead on? Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Indrani, Suhas.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Maya.
Thank you so much, Maya. It's wonderful.